Okay, so let's start. When someone joins, he'll just join and do it on the flight. Okay, so I'm Nikola Bogdanov, and my ladies and gentlemen, I'll present you today Extreme Programming. First, let me tell you something about myself. I'm working for Musavasoft for, let's say, 7 years. I've been almost everything in the company, starting as a junior software engineer, and now I'm a team leader. I had the chance to work with one of the biggest companies in the IT area.
Presentations are starting in Track A, JavaScript performance analysis and testing by instrumentation, in Track B, extreme programming, and in Track C, animate and automate.
As I said, I had the chance to work with one of the greatest companies in the area, like SAP, VMware, all kinds of different projects, teams. I saw a lot of best practices, good solutions, and so on. And according to my PhD that I'm making in Sofia University, I'm really interested in all kinds of so-called modern practices for making our project life easier. And today, let's talk about some extreme programming. At first, when I was preparing for the lecture, I was thinking, what should I talk you about? And having in mind that we have only 45 minutes, and knowing how much information there is for this topic, because it's really a huge and complex process, I thought what it was for me when I met extreme programming for the first time. And it was actually like 10 months ago. Of course, I had some overview and background before that, but it was the first time when I was actually working with extreme programming. I was entering a new project for me. It was already developed project that they were developing for more than a year. It was developed by another company that was moving out, and we had to continue their work. So I expected I was expecting the normal mess, to find some old defects, legacy code, different kind of spaghetti code and so on. But I was amazed. It was one of the cleanest and most well-organized projects that I have ever seen. There were so many unit tests, feature tests. There were automated scripts for almost everything. Of course, there were some drawbacks. For example, there wasn't so much documentation. And it was a bit hard for me to get involved from the beginning, but as I said, because of the good structure and architecture, it was really easy for me to get in fit for, let's say, a couple of weeks. Another problem was that there were so many design patterns, architectural tricks and so on, that sometimes there was really magic code there, but it was a good opportunity for me to learn new stuff. And that's why my idea today is to inspire you, to provide you some sort of practical overview, some actual practices, and I hope some of you will go and find some more information about the full picture. At first, I'll start with what is not extreme programming. It's not a perfect cure. So every time when you see something, some practice, some suggestion, you compare it with yourself, with your situation, with your problems, with your team, and so on. And every time when I'm talking about some agile practice, I like to start with a problem. This is a problem that the bridges don't have, but almost all software solutions have. As you can see from the pictures, some bridge could be a really complex thing, a huge giant, I can say, architectural project, but it's almost every time built on time, in budget, and fortunately doesn't fall. On the other hand, looking in some software solution, it is almost never built on time, it's going out of budget every time, and it fails so often. What is the reason for this? The reason is this: the bridge is solving let's say a constant problem. It's not changing so much during the time. And as a software solution, we are solving some business problem mostly. And the business world is changing so fast, it's so dynamic, that let's say we're in the perfect world and we have a working product built on time and budget. It's really a common case to turn out that, okay, we built it, but it's not valuable anymore. So, having this in mind, the solution is the Agile Manifesto. We saw all this on the opening session, so I think maybe most of you have visited different other trainings for or lectures for some agile practice like Scrum and so on, and I think you have seen this, and now you're thinking, oh no, the Agile Manifesto again. But I want to think for this Agile Manifesto when you see some practice, because everything in the Agile world is actually solving some of these sentences. I'll give you an example. I expect most of you are familiar with Scrum. Am I right? And maybe most of you know what is the product owner, what's his role, and so on and so on. But basically, the product owner is just the solution for the third sentence. It's our communication point with the customer who is always on a hand. So let's talk about the actual extreme programming. It's invented in 1996. Updated in 2004 by Kent Beck. And the main idea is that the high quality software is equal to the high quality code. Another core principle is that we want to deliver everything that is needed when it's needed, not deliver something that will be used after a month. Having this approach, we give our customer the opportunity, if for some reason he wants to stop the project in some point of the time, then he'll receive something that is valuable and something that is working. There are also some additional principles that are going from these sentences. For example, in extreme programming, we say the team is a god. Why the team is a god? Because the team should deliver high quality code. If, for example, we have overtime, what that means? That means that we are tired and we are not producing high quality code. That means that we should provide the team everything he needs to achieve this high quality code. Every time when we talk about any agile practice, there are some loops, iterations inside, and here I want to point two things. The first is the feedback. With extreme programming, we are receiving feedback at any level. For example, we receive on constant basis feedback for our code. In every minute and every second, we receive feedback for our pair, the person with whom we are working. And in every minute from the unit tests that are created and executed every couple of minutes and so on. Just in short, how the things work. So basically, every time we take the most needed features, iteratively we create these features and we produce the so-called project heartbeat. That's something needed because our customers will have the visibility and will know that we deliver constantly the most needed things. And we achieve the visibility. As I said, this is actually the workflow. So everything starts with conversation with the customer. So based on these conversations, we create our stories, working in pairs using the test-driven development. We create the code for our stories. Before delivering them, we execute all the integration tests on our local environment. That's why it's a common case to see that the extreme programming teams work with the most modern technologies, because you can imagine that this integration test should run fast. We cannot wait for, let's say, a couple of hours to execute all the tests. And when the tests are accepted and not failing, then we go to the clean stage, to a clean environment. We execute the tests again. After that, we give the features to our customers for approval, for acceptance. And everything starts from the beginning. As I said, the things could go much deeper, but I'll not dive in this area now. I want to show you four practices: estimation, pair programming, test-driven development, and behavior-driven development today. When we are talking about estimation, maybe most of you are familiar with the poker planning, with the planning poker. I expect that, I'll go just shortly. We have the whole team together in a room or a virtual room, and they all vote for their estimates, and they debate these estimates and vote again and again and again till they reach a full consensus over the estimates. And this is the most common practice that is being used. But I think it's not working every time. For example, I've seen a lot of teams that after a couple of stories, let's say 5-10 stories, they start to lose their focus, to give the same estimates for every next story. And for me, the reason for this is that they are losing the visualization, which is a core principle of almost all agile methodologies. Because the idea is that we should compare all these stories between each other, and we have to see them all in front of us to be able to compare them. In losing this visualization, we start giving automatically and mechanically some estimates. That's why I want to show you another approach. It's called estimation game. Again, the goal is the same. We want to achieve to have estimates for our stories, for our work, and to achieve true trust in these estimates through the whole team. We have again the user stories, the Fibonacci numbers, and we split the game in two rounds. The first is called the big lineup, and the second, the what's your number. And let's play. So we have the team together in front of the whiteboard. We have the host that who prepares the stories. That could be the product owner, product manager, or the customer himself, or whatever. And the team is there, and they are discussing the stories, as you can see from the picture. And let's say our host is Frank. So Frank prepares the stories, and he invites the first player, Kira, to start with the first story. So she takes the story, she asks questions, she describes what she thinks about this story, and just plays the story on the middle of the wall. We have sticky notes. Then comes the next player who says, okay, that next story, describing it, thinking about it, asking questions, so on. And in the end, he says, okay, this story is more complex. I think we should put it on the right. Then comes the next player, Mark, and he says, okay, this story is a bit smaller, so we put it on the left. We could be in the situation when Jeff comes and says, okay, the current story is also small one, but it's not so easy as the third. So he just places it in the middle. After some rounds, we can have the situation when Kira comes and says, okay, I don't want to take the next story. I just think we made a failure. So she has this right to explain why she thinks some story is underestimated, and instead of placing a new story, she just moves this story on the right. Having this thing repeating over the time, we achieve all the stories placed on the whiteboard from left to the right, compared in their ordered in their complexity. Then we have the second round, the what's your number. We have sticky notes with the Fibonacci numbers, and the first player just takes the first and place it take the one and place it over the first story. After that comes the second, Mark, and he has to place the note with 2 points over the first story that he thinks is about twice bigger than the first one. And so on. After some iteration, we can be in the situation when someone comes and says, okay, I think we underestimated this story. It's not 21, it's 34. And look, he does not remove the 21, he just moves all the stories from the right and places 34. After a couple of iterations, everyone makes his turn as many times as he needs, as he thinks about. And at the end, we just take all the stories on the right of some point and place it below it. And we receive the actual estimation. And as I said, all the team had the chance to do as many turns as he needs or she needs, And we have the true belief, the true trust in these estimates. And something very important when you're playing this game. Don't forget the scotch tape. It's really important because the sticky notes are falling every time. Okay, let's talk about pair programming. I'll start with a child game. It's played in the kindergarten, where they're trying to teach the children to work in pairs. So they place all the children in front of the whiteboard, give them a marker, and ask them to draw a human's face. So they draw it. After that, they split the children into pairs and ask them to draw a human's face, but this time together in pairs. And here are the results. We have the soul drawing, which is really ordinary, it's not something special, it's a bit simple. And on the right hand, we have something more creative. We have something more colorful, more elements are there. So the children created something. They think more. And the idea is with extreme programming, pair programming, we should concentrate on more creative tasks. Not so much some manual work or something like that. And according to a study from University of Utah, using pair programming, we increase our work time with about 15%, but we decrease our bugs with 15%. So you can imagine what that means in terms of time, this 15% less bugs. When we're talking about some risk project with a difficult one, with a lot of defects, and so on. And before explaining how to do pair programming, let's explain where to do it. So this is the so-called open space. You can see there are no walls, there are no cubicles, no anything. And all the people are so close to each other, everyone that we need is on one hand from us, and we can reach him so easily. The conversation is so relaxed, so easy again. And if you see here, these two monitors, they are the same. And this is the actual workstation for a pair. You can see we have a single machine with double monitors, double mice with double keyboards. And both of them are sitting and writing code on a single machine. How it works? The main approach is called driver navigator. So we have the first player, the first developer, who is focused on code writing, so he thinks to not have some code failure, to use the right optimization, the right just coding approach. And the second one, the navigator, is the one who is focused on the in advance, so he thinks about not missing some corner case, if our business logic is okay here, and so on. But this, as you can see, is not so easy. Sometimes we can have problems. Sometimes the pairs maybe are not collaborating so well. So here I'll present you a couple of games. We all know about the gamification, it's the big thing today. And using these games, we can improve our performance, let's say. The first game is called silent programming. So when we have a pair with people that are arguing, are not working so much, not working so well between each other, ask them to work, let's say, for an hour or half an hour without saying anything and just writing code. So they should communicate only through the code. And you can see how this is really amazing working. The ping pong game is, we'll see after that in the test driven development. For example, we have three phases for writing our story. And in the ping pong, we ask the pair, the first player to write the first phase, second the second phase, then first the third phase, and they're switching their places again and again and again. And one thing that I forgot to say, when we're talking about driver navigator, it's good, it's the best practice is to switch their places after, let's say, an hour or a day or half a day, but they should switch. going back to the ping program, to the ping pong, so the collaboration is a lot better after this game, and the trust in our partner is also a lot better, because you can see that you have to trust him to write the first phase and to continue after him. The farsighted navigator is a practice that is used when we have this navigator that is concentrating to telling his driver what to do, and he's always trying to correct him. Okay, here you missed semicolon, here you can use something else, not four but Y or something, whatever. And with the farsighted navigator, we actually forbid the navigator to say any single technical word. No while, no for, no if, no whatever. And this approach, we teach our navigators to think for what they're supposed to think, for the business logic, and not for the code base. And the last is the yes and practice. So for, let's say for an hour, we ask the pair to start every conversation with the yes and words, and never with yes but or no. Going through this approach, you can see that many times the pair goes to a solution that both of them didn't think about at the beginning. So they're building on top of each other. It's really amazing how it works. The test-driven development is the next practice that we're going to talk about. You can see that from research, from 2008 from IBM and Microsoft, we increase our work time with about 15-35%, but we can decrease our bugs with, take a look, till 19%. It's really amazing how it works. And this is really a study that it's a complex, complex study. I have read a part of it and it's amazing. So what is the test-driven development? As you can expect, we write our tests before our code. Okay, let's start from this point. Imagine that we want to create a UI form from some of our customers. What we do normally, we draw some mockup, go to the customer and ask him to take a look at the mockup, to agree with something, to change something, and when he's agreed with this mockup, with all the changes, then we know, okay, we're starting implementing this front page, front end page. Okay, so this is the same thing, but in terms of code. So we're creating our tests as mockup for our code. So when we write all the tests and take a look and see, okay, we didn't miss any corner case, we have all the right cases covered, and so on, then we know we have the mockup for our code and we can go and actually realize it. In some more details, we always start with writing the tests. It's important these tests to fail. Why they should fail? Because we don't have the code. And after that, we satisfy these tests, really satisfy them without paying attention for some optimization and so on. And then we don't miss the third phase, which is being missed a lot of times, to go and optimize and make everything clean and shiny. Because, you remember, we're talking about high quality code, so this third phase is maybe the most important. And going a level further, we'll talk about the behavior-driven development. The behavior-driven development, you can see, it first makes our code, it gives some standards for writing our code much, everything looks much more humanish. You can see in the example how look some simple part of behavior-driven test compared to the test, to the some unit test. And here, what we're trying to achieve with the behavior-driven development are these four things. We have the specification, because when we open some behavior tests, we see in human readable sentences what our functionality does. we have our feedback and regression prevention when we run these tests constantly every time and every time when we finish something. And lastly, we have the granularity. When something fails, we know exactly which part of our project, of our which feature, which functionality is failing. And what is important is here, we log the behavior, not the code. Because going back to test-driven development, we are doing mostly unit tests. And the unit tests, they are logging the actual code. We can have the many times we have the situation when we write, for example, some sorting function, and we used the bubble sort, and after that we go back and change it to quick sort, and we have to change our tests also, which is sometimes a huge pain. With the behavior-driven development, we are walking the behavior. For us, it's not so important if you use quick sort or bubble sort or whatever sort. And an example of the behavior of behavior-driven behavior test. So here, this is an example from a technology called Cucumber. Our one Cucumber test looks like this. We open tests and just read humanish. Given a list of numbers, when I sort the list, then I will have the list will be in numerical order. So there is this technology gives us the opportunity to map this human sentences to the actual code, and just replacing the sorting will just point the sentence to the new code, and we don't go deep and change the unit test. Okay, I expect many of you to be QA engineers. So let's see what are the QAs doing in extreme programming. Because here till now we talk about all kinds of programming, writing unit tests, which everyone knows, developer work and so on. But let's see. At first, maybe many of you have been in a situation when the QA is joining the project, let's say, few weeks or even a month later after the project started, because they assume that there isn't something to test. But as you can see here in extreme programming, we really have code to be tested on day two of our project. We don't concentrate so much on the architecture or writing documentation on huge planning, and so we just sit, take the most needed feature, ask the customer what is most needed and start developing it. So the QAs have what to do on the day two of our project. It's really good approach to have the QAs involved in the test-driven development in the pair. We could have a pair between QA and the developer. And what we can achieve, for example, is that we write the acceptance tests before our code is ready. So this is because the QAs, they know the acceptance test, they know what should be done to be accepted, so they suggest, they say, they're telling to his partner what test should be implemented. So we have the acceptance test before the code, which is really powerful thing. Another situation that we can prevent is that, for example, maybe some of you have been also in this situation, we have the developer ready with his work, and he gives it to the QA or tester or whatever, so he has to test this functionality. And after that, the QA says, okay, here we missed some very important corner case. Or we missed, I asked the client, here we should implement something totally different, something else. And so the developer says, okay, I agree, but this wasn't in the description. I didn't know about this functionality, no one told me. So why should I write it? If you want me to write to create this additional thing, I should start from the beginning and to rewrite all my code or no. And having the QA working in the test-driven development, starting with the tests and involving deep in the development, he can think about these additional requirements before we write the code. And this could really help, and no developer will argue, okay, you want something additional, say it and we do it, but not after we are finished with our job. Okay, again, almost the same thing, having the QA in the work process, in extreme programming with test-driven development and pair programming, he can see a lot of things before, he can go ask, start conversations, talk with the customers and so on, and not after that. Another idea is that testers can provide useful skills, because every one of you know that it's up to the developer to test his own code. So this is the first testing, when the developer tests his own work. But the QAs, they are really good at testing. So if they pair, they can test. The manual testing could be a lot easier and with higher performance, because they know how to do exploratory testing or something else, something that I think almost no developer knows what exactly is exploratory testing. But the QAs know this, so they will ask him to start testing in some good approach. Close collaboration between developers and QAs is something that we also achieve. We don't have a situation when the QAs are in the one room, developers in the other, and they communicate through phone and some system for tracking, and they hate each other also, let's say. It's a bit joke, but sometimes they just don't want to talk between each other because these guys are just looking for my failures. Okay, but when they're working closely every day, they both where they both are responsible for what they create. And that's why this collaboration is really improved and much better. And at all, it's really great to have pairing between QAs and developers. I saw a lecture from a QA engineer about extreme programming, and she was explaining how her writing skills were improved working with some developer also. So this is good for the actual developers. She said, okay, I just was watching how he works. He had short keys for everything, and I was like a little child that was using only the mouse and so on. So she really improves her skills also. And this is the end of my lecture. It's really great to try pairing between QAs and developers. Thank you. Now we have about 13 minutes for questions. Yes, please. I don't know if someone should, maybe you should talk on the microphone, I don't know.
I don't think, it works, okay. I would like to ask, do you have any experience with pair programming in distributed teams, say when people are not in the same geographic location?
Yeah, so of course, distributed teams, so distribution is something that is pain for us, no matter what technology or what kind of process we're using. So we have to solve this issue somehow. But in terms of pair programming, it's really easy. Just use TeamViewer or something like that. It doesn't change anything. So, okay, the personal contact is a bit more far, but using some sort of TeamViewer or whatever other solution, you achieve really the workplace with the both computers, with the both monitors or same computer and so on. Both of them can write code. I've used this, for example, I was pairing with a guy in the US, and it was okay, we had to find a useful time that is appropriate for both of us, but I went to work a bit earlier, he stayed a bit later and so on. But it was no problem. So I was writing my code. He said, okay, here on line 32, this is here is this one that you're looking for. Oh, look here on line 34, you missed something or whatever. And it really works. Okay, other questions, please? You have more 10 minutes. You can try also from your place. I don't know. It's we're not so big.
The estimation game looks like a very long process. Is that right?
It depends on the number of our stories. No, if you want to estimate 100 stories, it doesn't matter what kind of estimation approach you're using, it will be long. If you're estimating 10 stories, it will be fast. But you're right, as a whole, maybe it increases somehow the time, but you have this visualization. So the visualization maybe makes it delay somehow the approach, make it a bit slower, but again, it's up to the number of the stories that you want to estimate. Okay? You can try from your place. It's not, the microphone is maybe far away.
So what's the most common practice in pair programming? How do you choose the pairs? Is it always random or?
So the question, yeah, I understand. Thank you. The question is how we choose the actual people that will participate in a pair. So, at one hand, it's not needed or it's not urgent or it's not whatever to have the same pair every time. So we can change the pairs. And this could be a nice approach if we have to use on some story and one of the players knows about it something, the other not so much, so they can work together and to become more information about the whole project at all. And it could depends, most of the time it depends on the particular or the current story. So we take a look at the story, okay, this story is best for this one, so he'll pair with that one. And that's it. Okay, more questions? More 8 minutes and a half? No questions? No. Okay. Then, are you sure? Someone? I'll use more 5 minutes then to explain you about another approach then. For example, in this company that was developing this project that I started with, they had some sort of pool of developers. It was really interesting that going back to the history of the project, in the same time, there were no more than 8 developers. But for 1 year, through this whole project, passed like 20 or 30 people. So they had this organization, internal organization. They have maybe other projects. And they're just taking people from the pool for some time and taking back other from the project in the pool for some other period. And it was really amazing how they achieve some sort of good level to the whole of their company. Of course, there are some things in that we should have in mind that maybe most of their projects using the same technology and maybe all of their projects have the same structure, but this actually is a good thing. But it was really amazing. For a year, 30 people through a project. And every time you have like 4 pairs. Okay.
Last question.
Yeah.
Would you put two programmers with different level of experience in a single pair? Is it a good practice or a bad practice?
I'll answer. So again, the question is it okay to put two programmers with different skill levels? And I can extend the question. For example, we could have, is it okay to have a real junior and some high performance person. And if you try looking something through the net for pair programming, everywhere you see that they said pair programming is a programming practice. It's not a studying practice. It's not for learning. So if you want to achieve some sort of learning process, you do a learning process. But it's not pair programming. If both of them are programmers, real programmers, no, they are not studying how to write 4 cycles or what is recursion or something like that, then it's really okay to work together. But as I said, they should not teach each other how to write code. They should know, they should be at least on this level that they are good programmers, But after that, if the first one is really more involved in the project, he knows everything, it's really great to put a newer in the project who just try to be oriented and to look through the logic and doesn't know. Okay?
One additional question. Well, in your experience, did you see any, exact measurements of the return of your investment when you introduce pair programming? Because you said that the project will take like 15 to 35% longer, and we will have decrease in the bucks with 50 to 90%. But in terms of money,
okay,
does it actually pay out?
At first, maybe I should point that when I was talking about these percents, they were for actual work time. So for the time for code writing. So we increase our time for writing codes. That means, let's say, if we are in pairs, we produce 2 stories for a sprint. If we are not in pairs, we produce 3 stories in a sprint. But this is just in the terms of code writing. But you know that the story is ready when it meets the definition of done and when the story is accepted. So when it meets the acceptance criteria. And a lot more, so if we talk for projects with high risk for problems and defects, the time will be actually decreased for the whole project to be created, because we'll fix less, we'll have less work for testing and so on. So the idea is that we'll increase a little bit the working, the code writing, but we'll decrease the whole work as a whole. For example, this project that I was working in, if someone asked me how long it will take, approximately I would say 2 years, a year and a half. And these guys did hold this code for, let's say, 9 or 11 months. They were really monsters for me. Of course, as I said, there wasn't documentation, but they just said there are also other practices in extreme programming, that the early refactoring and so on. But all this helped to be extremely efficient, because they are concentrating only on optimizing and delivering. And yeah.
One question for me: how do developers feel when they participate in programming, in pair programming? Do they feel that they can really show what they are capable of, or they are kind of
It's a bit tricky question, because at the end it's up to the person. There are people who are not so open-minded, a bit more closed, and doesn't want to talk so much with someone, but they still could be good programmers. But for me as a whole, it's for me myself, it's really nice to work so close with someone and to discuss with someone the actual code that you're writing now. You say, okay, here should I use this? Do we forget something or something like that? So for me, I'm more communicative person, it's really nice. But as I said, it could be not so nice for such people that are more, that want more privacy and so on. By the book, when you're doing pair programming, you don't need code reviews, because actually the second head reviews your code. And I think if, of course, they are doing a good job and they are working with high performance, if they're paying real attention, the reviewing is not a process for, let's say, 5 minutes between my own task. Okay, I should be fast. Okay, here you missed something, fix it, and it's okay. But here you work with this person and he reviews your code more, really in constant base, really in integration level. So again, when you're doing pair programming, it's by the book, it's you don't need reviewing your code. Okay? We have 45 minutes, seconds. Okay? Thank you very much. I hope it was useful for you and something interesting. As I said, there is a lot more information. The whole process is real deep process. Take a look. This is a process, not a methodology. It's not like Scrum. In Scrum, you have, okay, you have meetings, you have these roles, but do the work, you do the job as you want. Here, the things, here we have a process. It's exactly set how you should do your job. You should do test-driven development, integration tests, so on, so on, so on. Okay, thank you.